Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Last American Aristocrat, The Brilliant Life and Improbable Education of Henry Adams by David S. Brown, read by Jacques Roy. For my teachers, gratefully. I've outlived at least three quite distinct worlds since 1838. Henry Adams, 1915. Introduction. For some years now, a remarkable interest in the John Adams family has nourished a thick forest of books and biographies surveying the public and private lives of its resident presidents. Recognized as the nation's most prominent political dynasty, the family appears over and again as emblems of a vital, if irretrievable, past. Theirs, however, is a cottage industry incomplete. For looking a little further down the line of descent, it is evident that not one among them matched the marvelously improbable portfolio of Henry Adams. He seemed to know everybody, travel everywhere, and do everything. Historian, political reformer, journalist, novelist, world traveler, Washington wise man, and member, by investiture, of a venerable Tahitian island dynasty. These are just a few of the several identities he so casually adopted. Such occupations and attitudes he used to elude a pressure-packed political family familiar with depression, alcoholism, and suicide. His uncommonly wide horizons allowed, rather, for a respectable detour from the comparatively narrow paths pioneered by grandfather John Quincy Adams and great-grandfather John Adams, heads of state. One might argue that given the eclectic range of his resolutions, he led a rarer life than either. Born in a Boston still cleaving, as he once put it, upon a nest of associations so colonial, Adams observed from various angles America's Industrial Revolution, its Civil War, and its entry into the Great War. He met Lincoln and befriended Edith Wharton, bowed before Queen Victoria, and shared a Spartan meal in the unkempt Samoan home of Treasure Island's author Robert Louis Stevenson. He married into a family with strong ties to the transcendentalism of Emerson and Thoreau, visited Jefferson's Monticello with Jefferson's granddaughter, Sarah Randolph, and suffered, so he said, an indifferent, very badly served White House dinner with Theodore Roosevelt. From an anxious Paris, he witnessed the German invasion of 1914 and enjoyed in his final years the occasional company of a young, attractive political couple, Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt. Drawn to the unusually broad scale of Adams's relationships and experiences, I emphasize in this biography his importance as a transitional figure, one bridging the chasm between colonial and modern. To put this another way, I believe that to understand much of America's history, and more specifically its movement in the late 19th century toward an imperial, industrial identity, one both increasingly beholden to technology and concerned with the fate of the white race, is to understand Henry Adams. More than merely living a long and colorful life, Adams actively engaged and commented on his times, endeavoring to interpret their structure, pace, and meaning. In 1838, the year of Adams's birth, Sam Houston served as president of the Republic of Texas. The removal of the Cherokee Nation west of the Mississippi gave rise to the anguished expression "Trail of Tears." Frederick Douglass, carrying the identification papers of a free black seaman, escaped from bondage, and a 28-year-old Abraham Lincoln spoke on the perpetuation of our political institutions before the Springfield, Illinois Young Men's Lyceum. Many older American citizens at that time had been subjects of the British Empire. 80 years later, in 1918, the year of Adams's death, few relics of the early American Republic remained. The Ford Motor Company was coming off its biggest year to date, selling an astounding 735,000 automobiles. Babe Ruth smacked 11 home runs for the Boston Red Sox in what proved to be the final season of the dead ball era. James Joyce's controversial novel Ulysses began serialization in the American modernist literary magazine Little Review. And Woodrow Wilson, attending the Versailles Peace Conference, became the first U.S. president to travel outside of the Western Hemisphere while in office. Kellogg's and Coca-Cola, Budweiser and Buick were on the rise. Adams, the child of an impossibly distinguished New England family, assumed something of a divided perspective, for the residue of regional custom in America quite emphatically gave way as he grew older to stronger and more eclectic currents. The Dutch-speaking Martin Van Buren, the first New Yorker and first candidate of non-British Isle ancestry to become president, the year prior to Henry's birth, might conveniently be identified as a harbinger of change. He reigned, if only for a single term, over a rising republic. Expansion across the frontier, coupled with a lessening of suffrage restrictions for white men, resulted in a dramatic increase of voters, from roughly 400,000 in 1824 to some 2.4 million by 1840. Henry grew up with an increasingly restless, ethnically complex, and democratic nation that had moved beyond the purview of its former first families. But far from defending his own class, he wondered at the mystery of its virtual extinction in a land of plenty. "How few of our college mates, with all their immense advantages," he wrote his brother Charles late in life, "seem to have got or kept their proportional share in the astounding creation of power since 1850. To leave the impression, however, that Adams languished in the past, alienated from his times, would be an error. He embraced the fruits of invention, traveling in the latest Mercedes, the fastest Union Pacific luxury train cars, and the smoothest steamships, purchasing a never-used ticket for the Titanic's return voyage. A connoisseur of spiritual expressions, he dropped his boyhood Boston Unitarianism to sample Buddhist, Catholic, and South Seas ceremonies and aesthetics. When writing selectively of his life in his most well-known work, The Education of Henry Adams, 1918, he famously rejected the parameters of classic memoir for an irony-laced narrative that challenged long-ingrained notions of material progress in America. Though a product of colonial trappings, he clearly traced with real interest the various tributaries of contemporary social, cultural, and industrial development. This enthusiasm, attuned to the surface and sweep of civilizational change, is illustrated well in Henry's vicarious, if telling, connection to America's emerging naval prowess. Its rather brisk evolution implied other far-reaching innovations. In early March 1862, while Adams served in London as secretary to his father, the U.S. minister to the Court of St. James's, a brief battle raged between Union and Confederate ironclad warships, the Monitor and the Virginia, in Hampton Roads, a deep water channel leading to the Chesapeake Bay. Though inconclusive, the four-hour duel offered an unsettling lesson that reverberated across the Atlantic. "Only a fortnight ago," Henry wrote shortly after the skirmish, "the British shockingly discovered that their whole wooden navy was useless." Just how useless became undeniably evident some years later when, in 1907, Adams's Washington neighbor, Theodore Roosevelt, sent an American armada, nicknamed the Great White Fleet, on a 14-month world cruise, making 20 port calls and touching 6 continents. 18 vessels in all participated, with the battleship USS Connecticut leading the flotilla out of Hampton Roads. Henry may have felt a particular satisfaction, even a sense of possession, in the squadron's launch. For back in 1775, an insistent John Adams had prodded a plodding Continental Congress into building ships to defend the colonies. This poetic, blue water phase of maritime development suggested certain modest standards of size and scale, mission and mandate rendered obsolete by the shining steel fleet unleashed by Roosevelt. As a more general way of reading the world, such transitions as that from sail to steam captivated completely Henry's historical imagination. Accordingly, he worried as Wall Street financiers and Chicago factory owners gained power in the Republic. He watched as distances shrank before the sovereignty of trains, telegraphs, and beginning in 1883, time zones, and he wondered about Darwinism's bid to become the very best substitute for religion. Determined to experience this change directly, he hunted down the era's new ideas and inventions by attending several international expositions. A journey to St. Louis's 1904 World's Fair culminated in a rather happy roller coaster ride. the finest thing I ever did in my life. Adams wished as well to know expiring peoples and places before they gave way completely to outside energies and economies. Such interest spurred his travels to the South Seas, Cuba, and Russia, the last at least 3 generations behind us, he assured one correspondent. Similar elegies were conducted at home. Shortly after the 1890 federal census reported the closing of the nation's western frontier, he spent 2 months with a small party.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.